Do you remember?
We studied about big O notation.
Big O notation. That's right. Okay. So I will just review you about this, right? Maybe you will try to remind about this concept, right? First of all, I will introduce you what does it mean by the time and space complexity. In order to analyze an algorithm, analyzing an algorithm means to determine the amount of resource, for example, time and memory. Normally, we will measure in the time, right, that needed to be executed. Okay, so if you want to make your algorithm more efficient, the first thing that you may have to keep in mind that you have to reduce the time, right, of execution. Okay, so algorithms are generally decided to work with an arbitrary number of input. For example, if you have 10 number of inputs, right, compared with the input with 1,000 or 10,000 inputs, right, it should be in the, how can I say, in the, what kinds of the complexity that this algorithm will perform, right? So the efficiency and complexity of an algorithm is stated or is expressed in terms of time and space complexity. Normally we will focus on time, right? Because if you can make your algorithm faster, right, it means that your algorithm is more efficient, right? And sometimes I would say that in some specific case, right, we have to use the space in order to space complexity in order to measure about the efficiency of an algorithm. So when we talk about the time complexity, right, the time complexity of an algorithm is the running time of a program as a function of the input size. So it will depend on the input size n, right? So you can see that the time complexity, normally we will describe it in terms of the big O notation. And big O notation will have to be written in terms of O, big capital O, and parentheses n, right? And n will be the function of the input size. Okay, what does it mean by function? Function of n, function of n square, function of log n, for examples. Okay, similarly, the space complexity of an algorithm is the amount of computer memory or physical memory that we will use in the program execution. Okay, so if, for example, if you want to calculate for what, for something, like, and you need to allocate the memory in your main memory. For example, yesterday lab, right, we talk about the matrix 2x2, right? But in the complex or complicated task, right, maybe you have to use 100x100 matrix size, right? This will make your program run slowly, right? And we call this case of the space complexity, right? Sometimes the number of machine instruction which program execute is also called time complexity. So instead of using n, right, as a function of input size, maybe you can count the number of the instruction or the number of statements in your program. And this will be the time complexity computation as well. This number is primarily depend on the size of the program's input and the algorithm used, okay? And the next thing is the space complexity, right? The space needed by a program depend on the following two parts, right? The first part is the fixed part. It means that if you design an algorithm, right, there are some variables that you have to declare in the for the variables, especially in the array, right? So if you include the space needed for storing instruction constants, variables is the one that I have just told you, and the last one is a structured variable like array and structure, right? We are going to talk about the structure and union later, right? And the next one is a variable part, right? We have fixed part and variable part. Variable part will vary from program to program, right? It includes the space needed for a recursion stack. And for structure variable, for example, malloc. Do you remember when you want to dynamic allocation during the program execution, what shall we do? If you want to allocate more memory, more physical memory, right, during the program execution, how can we do? What we have to do is we have to use malloc, right, in C program to allocate new memory, right? This we call the variable part or the dynamic part of the space allocation, right? By the way, running time requirements are more critical than memory requirements. Okay, so that's why I told you that we will focus on time complexity, right? For the space complexity, it's very used. Okay. So from now on we will focus on the running time efficiency of algorithm or the time complexity. Do you remember how many cases do we have to concern about? When we talk about the time complexity, right, we will concern or we will focus on the worst case, average case, and the best case. What does it mean by the worst case running time, right? Worst case running time, as its name, right? It is the time, the worst case for the running time of the algorithm. That is an upper bound or the maximum on the running time for any input, right? So having the knowledge of worst case running time gives us an assurance that the algorithm will never go beyond this time limit. So this will be the upper bound or the maximum limit of the running time for an algorithm, right? So we call worst case. So the best case will be in opposite, right? The best case will be the lower bound, right? Okay, yeah. The best case, right, will be the optimal condition, right? Or the best solution of the running time, right? And we also have the average case running time, right? Average case running time of an algorithm is an estimate of the running time for an average input, okay? So it would be, you can calculate for this if you have many number of inputs, right? And you have many samples, right, and then you try to find the average case by finding the mean of several cases, right, by divided by n cases. Okay, so sometimes in order to find the average case, right, we can specify it in terms of the input, right, when the input is randomly drawn for a given distribution. Okay, randomly pick up, right? And then you can find the average case for the algorithm. So average case running time assume that all inputs of a given size are equally likely. Okay, are equally likely. And for the best case, right? So when we consider about the best case condition, right? We are going to find to analyze an algorithm under optimal condition. For example, the best case for simple linear search on an array occur when desired element is the first in the list. Do you get the point? Suppose we have an array, right? If you want to find a specific value, right? And accidentally, the first element is in the list. This element is at the first element in the list, so it will be the best case. Okay, this is an example of the best case, right? However, while developing and choosing an algorithm to solve a problem, we hardly base our decision on the best case performance. That's right. Mm-hmm. It's always recommended to improve the average performance and the worst case performance of algorithm. Okay, because the best case solution or the best case learning time is not practical. It's impractical. So normally when you are trying to develop or improve your algorithm, the best thing that you may have to concern that is the average performance or the average case or the worst case performance, improve the best case perform or the worst case performance, because the worst case is the lower or the upper bound. That is the maximum possible time, right, for this algorithm. So you want to reduce this time, okay? So the next slide, we will talk about the time and space test of. So we always talk about, we want to get the best algorithm ever, right? So the best algorithm to solve a particular problem is no doubt the one that requires less memory space and take less time, right? But in practice, right, it's not possible, right? If you want to reduce the time, maybe you have to increase the memory space to help you to for the calculation. But in other words, right, maybe you will have the small space, right? You will have to take more time in order to execute your algorithm. So this one will have to be, or you as a programmer, you have to trade off this time and space conditions, okay? The reason is that for a specific problem, you can have more than one algorithms in order to solve this problem, but you may have to trade off between the time and space. If you have infinite, or I can say if you have more space, right, in order to make your program faster, right, maybe you can use the space in order to reduce the time, right? That would be a case, right? For example, if you want to run a program, right, on your computer, notebook, right, you will have space as much as you want. But compared to if you are trying to develop an application on mobile, right, you have a small number of the space of memory, right? So your algorithm has to be time consuming. Okay, do you get the point? So it depends on your device, your hardware, right? That you will select time or space. Therefore, it's not uncommon to sacrifice one thing for the other, right? So maybe you have to choose one, right? If you choose time, right, maybe you have to expand or you have to use more space, right? But if you use space, you have the limitation with the space. You have to, sometimes you have to increase the time, right, in order to wait for the result. For example, I've just told you about the mobile application, right? This is the case that you cannot run everything onto your mobile. Sometimes you may have to run your program from the server side, right? So you have to wait from the connection to the server and then execute to the server and then download the result to the mobile. So in this case, right, you may have to sacrifice the time, right? Because you have no idea of how to use the memory in the mobile, right? This is a good example for time and space test of. But normally, if you develop the program in your notebook or in your desktop computer, right? So you don't have to care about the space much, right? So what you have to do is you have to increase. No, you have to decrease the time computation. So this is what we call time complexity. Okay, so you know, the next topic that you have to study is if you want to express the time or the space complexity, or okay, to make it shorter, like I will call just only time complexity. So you can express it in terms of the function fn, right? Where n is a input size, right? For a given instance of the problem to be solved, right? And expressing the complexity is required when we want to predict the rate of growth of complexity as the input size of the problem increases, right? Okay, and in this way, we will call it, right? The most widely used notation to express this function is Fn is a big O notation. Okay, maybe you are familiar with the name big O notation. Big O notation will provide you about the upper bound of the complexity. Okay, and big O notation when we talk about big O notation, that means that we are going to talk about the algorithm efficiency. If a function is linear, what does it mean by linear? The linear means we don't have any loop or any recursions, right? The efficiency of that algorithm or the running time of that algorithm can be given as the number of instructions it contains. Okay, it will be n, right? However, if an algorithm contains loops, right, then the efficiency of that algorithm may vary depending on the number of the loop and the running time of each loop in the algorithm. Okay, so now we have the two ways in order to calculate for the algorithm efficiency. The first one, if there is no loop, right, you can just simply count it as one or a constant. But if you have loop, right, you have to count the number of the loop, right, n square or something. Okay, let's just see this one. This is a linear loop, right? For this example, you can see that this is a for loop, right? I from 0 to I less than 100, right? And I plus plus, and then statement box will be the number of this one will be repeatedly executed, right, according to the number of the loop here. So when you see this one, right, n is equal to 100, right? So in this case, what is the time complexity of this one, this loop for iteration? This is a linear loop, right? So the time complexity will be n. This previous slide is n, right? The time complexity is n. And how about this? If we change a bit about the incremental step of I, right? I plus equal to 2. So the number of iteration will be half of the number of the loop, right? So fn will be n divided by 2. But in this case, the big O is still n, right? Even it is n divided by 2, but this is a function of n. Okay, this is a linear loop. The next one is a logarithmic loop, right? When you change a bit, right, to the step, right, I can be multiplied by I is equal to I multiplied by 2, right? Or we can have a short form of that statement, right? Or we can use I divided equal to 2, right? So when you consider this loop, right, I will be from 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 13, 32, 64, 128, 256, 512, and the last one is 1024, right? So is the number of the loop will be about 9 or 10, right? 9 or 10, right? Because 2 raised to the power 10 is equal to 1024, right? So in this case, we will call logarithmic loop, right? So the number of loop will be reduced by 2 for each time, right? So that's why the function fn will equal to log n, because when n is equal to 1000, the number of the iteration could be log 1000, which approximately equal to 10. Okay. Do you understand this? If you understand, please press 1, right, in your chat box. Actually, I'm wrong, right? Actually, I should ask the one who don't understand, right, to press and to give me the number in the chat box. Okay, I can see that only less than 20 students can understand this one. Okay, if I go back to this, like this fn is equal to this fn is equal to n, right? Because I plus it will increment one at a time. But this one, it will increment two at a time, but it's still n divided by two. But in the case that you change this a bit, I multiply that equal to two, it means that I is equal to I multiply that by two, right? So the number of the subsize will be in logarithmic function, right? It will not like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 2, 4, 6, 8, something like that. It will like 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, right? This kind is the log, is this is the graph of the logarithmic function, right? And the number of loop will be log n base 10. Okay, in this case, oh, sorry, log n base 2, right? In this case, n is equal to 1000, right? Log 1000 base 2 is equal to 10. Am I right? I think I'm right. And similar to the case of division, right? We reduce the number of I divided by two, right, at a time. So the number of the number of for loop here will be equal to the left hand side. So it is the logarithmic function that is the log. Okay, I think you understand about the logarithmic loop. The next one, nested loop, right? Loops that contain loops, right, can be called nested loop, right? In order to analyze nested loop, right, you will determine the number of the iteration each loop completes. Okay, it's very easy, right? We have a loop inside the loop, right? So we will start from the linear loop. Linear loop will be n square, okay? Linear loop, linear loop will be n square. So you will have to, okay, it will be the, it can be analyzed as the quadratic algorithm, okay? But we have the linear loop, linear logarithmic loop. What does it mean? It means that the outside will be, the outer loop is the linear, right? The inner loop is the logarithmic. Right, so in this way, it will be n log n. Okay, n log n, and this one is quadratic loop. In a quadratic loop, the number of iteration in the inner loop is equal to the number of iteration in the outer loop. So it will be n multiplied by n. That is n square. Fn is equal to n square, right, for this nested loop. And we also have a special loop, right? Dependent quadratic loop. How can we find this independent quadratic loop? In the dependent quadratic loop, the number of iteration in the inner loop is depend on the outer loop. Let's see the code below, right here, right? For I is equal to 0 to 10, right? I plus plus and J will be dependent on the outer loop, right? J is equal to 0 and J less than or equal to I. When I is equal to 0, so this for loop will be execute once. And if this I is incremented to 1, so we have 2 loops. So the summation of the number of the iteration can be the summation of 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 and so on. So in this case, you will have to until plus 10, right? So this one will be equal to 55. Okay, so the efficiency of such code can be given as n multiplied by n plus 1 divided by 2. Right, this is the formula for calculating the summation of I, right? Summation of I is equal to n plus 1 divided by 2. This is we call dependent quadratic loop. This loop will be occurred when the inner loop is depend on the outer loop. Okay, here we come to the last part of the chapter 2. That is a big O notation, right? Big O notation will be used for calculate or measure for the efficiency of an algorithm, right? It will concern with what happened for every large value of n or the input number n, right? For example, if a sorting algorithm perform n square operation to sort just n element, so we can describe it as a big O n square, okay? And this is a mathematic definition of the big O notation. Suppose we have two functions fn and gn, right? And can be defined on a positive integer number n, right? So fn is equal to big O gn. Big O gn, right? Gn will be the formal function, okay? And that is f of n is a big O of gn, g of n. Okay, even only if positive, if you can find a positive constant C and N exists when Fn is less than or equal to C, G, N. Okay, it means that if you can find a constant C, right, and multiply by Gn, right, Gn will be the formal function, right, it means that for large amount of data, fn will grow no more than a constant factor than gn. So g provides an upper bound. So that we call big O notation. This is a way that we have to prove for the big O notation. So let me give you an example. Okay, before we go to the example of the big O notation. Okay, it can be noted here that c is a constant which depend on the following factors. Right, the programming language to be used, the quality of compiler or interpreter, the CPU speed, the size of main memory, to access time, knowledge of the programmer and algorithm itself. Right, this is what does it mean? If you want to explain about why you have to pick up 1C and then multiply it by Gn, right? And it will be less than or equal to, this will be greater than Fn. So we will call Gn is a big O notation of Fn is equal to Gn. Okay, so if you want to prove for the big O notation, the first thing that you have to find, that is a C, a constant C, right? To compose the new function that is greater than or equal to fn or the given function fn, right? Okay, sometimes we can write big O notation like this as a strict upper bound for fn, right? So big O notation is simply written by fn is a member of big O gn, right? Big O gn will be a superclass, right? And fn is a smaller subclass of big O gn. But in order to write this, right, is I don't like this pattern, right? So if I want to write a big O notation of fn, right, I will write big O gn. So in order to find big O gn, right, we have to find a c, right, a constant c, in order to make this statement true, right? Fn less than or equal to c gn when c is greater than zero, and n is greater than n zero as well in some specific n zero, right? If you can find that c and n zero, right, so you can find the asymptotically tight upper bound for fn or big O notation. For this, for the example of the function in this, right, big O n raised to the power 3, right, is a big O of which function? N 2.9, is that true? Okay, let me give you an example so you can understand how to calculate for the big O notation. Maybe the question might be to show 4n square is equal to big O n raised to the power 3. So you have to follow by the definition, right? You have to find c, right? C in order to multiply to the n raised to the power 3, right? So you can write 0 SN and CGN, right? And 0, you pick up, or this is a 4N squared less than CN less to the power 3, right? And then subdivided by N less to the power 3. So you can get 0, 4N less than C, less than or equal to C, right? Divided by n raised to the power 3, right? And then, so now if you, okay, now determine the value of c, right? You can see that 4 divided by m is maximum when n is equal to n. 4, right, will be equal to n, right? If n is 5, 6, 7, 8, it will be less than 1, right? So 4 is, c is 4. Right, so when you pick up C is 4, right? And to determine the value of N0, right, you can use 0 is less than 4 over N0 less than 4, right? Because we pick up 4 for C, okay? And then if we okay, in this case, right, you move N0 to another side and use remove and move 4 to this side, right? You can get divide. 4 divided by 4 is N, right? N less than or equal to N0. So if you pick up N is equal to 1, then you can find this solution, right? 0 is less than 4 N less to the power 2 less than or equal to 4 less to the power 3. So this statement holds true, right, forever. So you can say that for our N greater than N 0 is equal to N to 1, right? And then C is equal to 4. So we can prove that big O of 4 4 n square big O of 4 n square is equal to n raised to the power 3. Okay, so in order to prove for the big O notation, I think you have already a study from the discrete map with Dr. Narimon, right? So this is just I want to recall you something about the big O notation. For this example as well, right? Oh, 400 n raised to the power 3, right? And this one is n squared. But in order to make it easier, right? Normally when you see like this, like you will eliminate this one n squared, and you can eliminate this one, and then you can guess the result, right? For this example, this one holds true because the biggest number of the power of this function is 3, right? N raised to the power 3. So you can get big O n raised to the power 3. But the most difficult part of finding or to prove the big O notation is to find C and to find n. So in order to find C and to find n, right, you can use this definition and follow the step like this, so you can get a C and N easily. Okay, I'm not going to talk into detail, but maybe you can recap or recall you about the big O notation. Okay, and I will go back to this page, right? This example of the big O notation, if Gn is 10, right? Its big O will be 1, right? Because this one is constant. Please remember that if this one is a constant, right? You have to write the big O. Big O is equal to 1, okay? For this case, like 2, n raised to the power 3, n power 3 plus 1, big O will be big O n power 3. This one, the highest power is 2, big O is n power 2. This one is big O n power 3, right? And you can see that you cannot just pick up any big O, right? We have the formal or the category of big O notation, right? There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, about 5 categories, right? Constant time, it will be big O 1. Linear time, big O n. Logarithmic time is big O log n. Polynomial time is big O n power k, right? When k is greater than 1. We also have the linear logarithmic, right? Big O n log n. I didn't provide it here, right? And we also have the biggest one, right? Big O exponential time, right? Big O 2 power n. Right, and you can see that when the number increases, number n increases, right? Oh, big O n raised to the power 3 will be very big, okay? And this one will be in the sort, it is sorted in ascending order. Big O constant time, linear time, logarithmic time, linear time, linear logarithmic time, how polynomial time, and the last one, or no, this one is exponential time. Okay? Okay, I think that's all for the chapter 2, right? Do you have any question up to now? Okay, if you don't have any question, I will give you a short break for 10 minutes. And